Why should we give land to the Indians when it clearly says on the paper it belonged to the farmers?
But surely you must realize that this is their home. These indigenous tribes have been living on this land for hundreds of years.
Listen, this world is not fair. Some people win, some people lose. The whole world think they can tell Brazil what to do with her land. Sorry, no. We do what we please.
Nossa terra. Ela está sempre em movimento. Uma sinfonia dinâmica de forças, todas trabalhando juntas, soprando vida aos quatro cantos do mundo. E por milênios, culturas de todo o mundo a chamaram de mãe.
We live on an incredibly beautiful planet. A home that we will hopefully pass on to generations to come. But as years go by, it's becoming increasingly hard to imagine what kind of a world we're leaving behind us. We've spent the last 4 years traveling around the world, filming the stark reality that people now face from the threat of ecological collapse. It's now become very clear to us that there's one thing driving the destruction of our ecosystems faster than anything else. Let us show you how this very same thing might just also be our salvation.
And environmental scientists warn that we are fast approaching the point of no return if we don't make a substantial course reversal.
We see really serious catastrophic effects in the next few years, certainly in the next decade or two. The world will be completely different from the way it is now.
Desde 1900, vimos aumento dramático nos desastres climáticos no mundo. Já aconteceram 4 vezes mais desastres climáticos nos últimos 50 anos do que nos 100 anteriores.
We began to work together to move this issue onto the global center stage. There was a lot of discussion about the contribution from buildings and from industrial factories, but I became aware during that same period of time that there was another factor that was going undiscussed. And that is the role of animal agriculture, which I could see was playing some significant role around the planet. But this was the elephant in the room no one wanted to talk about.
Whatever environmental issue you want to look at, from species loss to water pollution to water use to climate change, animal agriculture is one of the top causes.
The critical, widespread negative impact of animal agriculture on our planet is undeniable. Severe global crises, from climate change and environmental damage to species extinction, hunger, poverty, disease, and antibiotic resistance, all of these have direct connections to animal agriculture and the massive inefficiency of our current food production systems.
Já em 2009, um relatório publicado pela WikiLeaks expôs as conversas entre executivos da Nestlé e agentes oficiais dos Estados Unidos chamados de Tour do Horizonte. Em sua pesquisa, os executivos da Nestlé demonstraram que a água doce do mundo se acabaria nos próximos 30 anos. Ela dizia que uma das maiores causas do nosso desvio por essa rota catastrófica é a grande demanda mundial pela carne.
If you look at the impact that food choice has on global warming, it's very significant. Eating meat is huge for global climate, and that's something where personal choice is the determining factor. So there's the only case I can think of where individual human choice would have a big effect would be food.
We're now over the line. And the idea that we're going to double meat production between now and 2050, this is just unsustainable. This is going to have to give. Our diet is taking us to an abyss.
A significant reason why livestock production has been having such a huge impact on greenhouse gas emissions is because of the large surfaces of forests that have been destroyed in order to make room for pastures and for the growth of soybean and maize for feedstock production.
Nossas florestas já foram cheias das formas de vida mais incríveis. Em anos recentes, começamos a desenvolver um apetite insaciável por carne e laticínios. E como a nossa demanda por mais carne cresceu, precisamos de mais e mais terra. Então, derrubamos e queimamos nossas florestas virgens, destruindo tudo em nosso caminho para dar lugar aos animais que queríamos comer. E como esses animais não podiam ser livres, como são na natureza, suas pastagens logo ficaram vazias. E assim precisávamos alimentá-los. E novamente derrubamos e queimamos mais e mais florestas, semeamos a terra com milho e soja transgênicos e os saturamos de pesticidas, herbicidas e fertilizantes químicos sintéticos. A agropecuária literalmente mudou a face do nosso planeta. A Mata Verde é usada para cultivos humanos, uma grande área que se estende pelo globo. E ainda assim, a área que usamos para pecuária, indicada em vermelho, hoje ocupa uma vasta área da nossa terra, uma área bem maior do que a usada para cultivos humanos.
Almost all the Earth's surface is now bears the mark of some kind of human impact, and most of that is livestock production.
Agriculture has transformed the planet like nothing else. To produce milk, we farm an area about the size of Brazil. To produce beef, we farm an area about the size of Canada, the United States, the whole of Central America, Venezuela, Colombia, and Ecuador combined. To produce eggs, we farm an area the size of Sweden. To produce aquaculture feed, an area about the size of the UK. A plant-based diet would reduce the amount of land required to produce our food by 3.1 billion hectares. That's an area the size of the entire African continent.
A Amazônia é a maior floresta tropical do mundo. Este mundo antigo e rico em biodiversidade está sendo substituído. Muitas vezes acredita-se que a maior parte da soja plantada no Brasil é para o consumo humano. Na verdade, menos de 6% da soja cultivada no mundo é consumida por humanos. A grande maioria é criada para ração animal. A soja é exportada em todo o mundo e usada para alimentar os bilhões de frangos, peixes, porcos e vacas que comemos todos os dias. As florestas não são só o lar de bilhões de espécies de animais e plantas, mas são também grandes reguladoras do meio ambiente. Dia a dia, elas respiram lentamente o dióxido de carbono, enquanto criam bilhões de toneladas de oxigênio para o nosso ar. Todo ano, estima-se que 18 milhões de acres de floresta são perdidos, quase o tamanho do país do Panamá. Acredita-se que cerca de metade das florestas tropicais antigas da Terra foram destruídas. E alguns cientistas previram que, a menos que medidas drásticas sejam tomadas mundialmente, em 2030, apenas 10% das florestas permanecerão vivas.
One of the most precious things we have in the world is our rainforests. The rainforests are literally being chewed away by farmers who know they can make money by cutting another acre and then another acre and then another acre for meat.
Nosso avô, naquele tempo, o cacique, então já falou: olha, você vai sofrer muito, porque o branco roralismo.
Todo ano, centenas de membros de tribos indígenas da floresta amazônica têm suas aldeias queimadas. Eles foram removidos de suas terras à força e muitos assassinados pelas milícias do agronegócio, que buscam tornar suas terras em fazendas de cultivo de soja para a ração animal. Uma das tribos mais afetadas é dos Guarani Kaiowá, no Mato Grosso do Sul.
Para nós indígenas, antigamente, as florestas que é a nossa casa. Quem começou a destruir a nossa aldeia é através da agropecuária.
Então derrubaram as nossas matas, destruindo os animais, os rios.
Eu estou falando, agora vai plantar soja, aí depois vai passar veneno, né? Tudo coisa. Vai passar adubo também, vai cair tudo no rio. E nós revoltando no Sotecorrá, para sustentar a nossa família.
So there was actually a report that came out in 2018, and they found that the world's top five livestock corporations now release more annual greenhouse gas emissions than ExxonMobil, Shell, and BP. It is crazy when you think about it, because the EU is spending £24 billion of taxpayers' money on livestock farming each year. And this is at a time when we are facing an ecological collapse and we drastically need to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. So it's no surprise that people are asking a lot of questions now about the fact that there seem to be some serious conflicts of interest going on here.
There's some very heavy lobbying going on of government, and I think that happens throughout the world. And it's just a historic thing that needs to be, I think, rebalanced.
As I've mentioned to you over the phone, I've worked with a number of large livestock companies around the world. So the way it works is that a representative from pays us usually up to €500,000. We then target the relevant politicians from different governments around the world, and motions are made to pass legislation in favor of the company's business strategies. For environmental policy, we can be very persuasive in order to abolish or heavily relax environmental regulations in government, so our clients have more freedom in their work. The other day we managed to kill proposed legislation that would have had a huge impact on the industry, based on a report from the UNFAO. You know, the industry is just concerned with growth, but the environmental data that's coming out now, it's really making that difficult for them.
Today, democracy does not always function as well as it should because of the huge influence that agribusiness corporations and livestock producers in particular exercise on decision making.
A former director of the United Nations Food and Agriculture Organization, Dr. Samuel Jutsi, warned as far back as 2010 that interventions by agribusiness lobbyists were blocking reforms that would offer better standards for human health and preserving the environment. Big animal agribusiness corporations and food producers' influence over political decisions about the regulation of their industry has long been a concern for campaigners who see the narrow interests of the industry taking widespread control.
If we have any doubt about how powerful this influence is, we can recall that, for example, when the Advisory Committee on Dietary Guidelines in the US made recommendations to the US government as to how dietary guidelines should be shaped, they were blocked by this very powerful lobby of agribusiness interests.
Em 2013, a Organização de Alimentos e Agricultura da ONU publicou um relatório chamado Vencendo as Mudanças Climáticas com a Pecuária. O relatório alega que a indústria agropecuária é responsável por mais emissões de gases estufa do que todos os transportes globais juntos. Cada vez mais cientistas acreditam que o impacto da agropecuária é, na verdade, muito pior do que indicado no relatório da FAO.
There are close ties between the research organizations and governments and government policy and industry. It's very pervasive because livestock industries depend on government policies that support them.
The FAO report was prepared within the FAO by specialists of agriculture and livestock production, not by specialists of the environmental issues associated with agricultural production. I believe that a more serious concern, of course, is that the International Meat Association was involved in preparing the report, which does raise the question of the independence with which the study was prepared.
Government policy in that regard is not for the benefit of the land, it's for the benefit of the industry.
No seu relatório, a FAO fez parceria com os países membros, organizações não governamentais e muitas outras organizações, incluindo a Federação de Fabricantes de Alimentação Europeia, a Federação Internacional de Laticínios, o Secretariado Internacional de Carne, a Comissão Internacional de Ovos e o Conselho Internacional de Aves. Em uma indústria de mais de US$1 trilhão, não são essas justamente as instituições que têm mais a perder com um relatório científico contra a agropecuária? Poucas pessoas sabem mais sobre o oceano do que a doutora Sylvia Earle. A doutora Earle foi a primeira mulher a se tornar cientista-chefe da Administração Nacional Oceânica e Atmosférica dos Estados Unidos e manteve o recorde de mais tempo caminhando no fundo do mar sem cabos de segurança do que qualquer outra pessoa.
When I was a child, the idea of a dead zone in the ocean was not even in our vocabulary. But in the 20th century, as agriculture began to greatly expand, the areas around the coast began to show signs of wear and tear. The first most notorious spotlight area, I think, was off the Gulf of Mexico. And it has simply grown over the years, an annual phenomenon that is coincident with the application of massive amounts of fertilizer.
Os milhões de quilômetros quadrados usados no cultivo de ração para animais que comemos são saturados com fertilizantes nitrogenados. O nitrogênio escorre pelos campos, rio abaixo e, por fim, chega aos nossos oceanos. A água rica em nitrogênio estimula o supercrescimento das algas, causando florescimentos tão grandes que podem ser vistos do espaço. As algas tomam oxigênio da água, levando à morte da vida marinha ao seu redor. Desde o aumento da demanda por carne, essas zonas mortas de baixo oxigênio crescem cada vez mais.
There are hundreds of dead zones that have developed all around the coastlines of the world. And okay, people say, that's too bad for the fish. So sorry, fish. But we need to understand that what we do to the ocean, we're doing to ourselves. I want others to see and to see for themselves. This is all we've got, this little blue miracle.
Algumas pessoas acreditam que substituir a carne pelo peixe beneficiará o nosso planeta. Isso simplesmente não poderia estar mais longe da verdade. Se o oceano morrer, nós humanos provavelmente morreríamos com ele, pois parte do ar que respiramos foi criado pelo oceano. Segundo o maior periódico de ciências, o Nature, já perdemos quase 90% de todos os peixes grandes do mar desde a década de 50. Um dos estudos mais detalhados realizados sobre estoques de peixe, também no periódico Nature, afirmou que no ritmo da pesca atual, as peixarias do mundo devem entrar em colapso em menos de 30 anos. Segundo o IPBES, o órgão intergovernamental que avalia o estado da nossa biodiversidade, a principal causa da extinção da vida marinha é a pesca. Nosso gosto por peixe está destruindo a vida dos oceanos.
Today we have agreed on fishing opportunities for European fishermen worth more than 5 billion euros and benefiting more than 50,000 fishermen. The catches agreed today will continue to make the European fishing industry highly profitable also in 2019.
Noruega, um país lindo com paisagens incríveis. É também um lugar com segredos sombrios. A Noruega é uma das maiores exportadoras de peixe do mundo, uma indústria que vale bilhões de euros para a economia do país. Como a maior parte dos peixes grandes do mar estão à beira da extinção, pescadores adotam a piscicultura como a forma de criar peixes em ambiente controlado. A Noruega produz mais salmão e bacalhau em cativeiro do que qualquer outro país do mundo. Cerca de 70% dos peixes que comemos hoje vem de fazendas artificiais de peixes. Com milhares de peixes mantidos próximos em gaiolas pequenas no mar, doenças e piolhos se espalham e se tornaram um grande problema. Como resultado, pesticidas, desinfetantes e antibióticos são amplamente usados para manter os peixes vivos até chegarem ao mercado. Para se livrar dos piolhos dos peixes, barcos de bombeamento são usados, que sugam os peixes em um aspirador de água gigante. Os peixes passam pelo sistema e, ao mesmo tempo, são aquecidos a altas temperaturas ou banhados em químicos que removem a maior parte dos piolhos antes de serem jogados de volta na gaiola. Os peixes são banhados em soluções químicas como peróxido de hidrogênio, azametifós, para matar parasitas e doenças, e recebem ração com químicos como teflubenzuron, emamectina e diflubenzuron, que, por natureza, são tóxicos. Pesquisadores descobriram que resíduos dessas substâncias podem acabar nos peixes e, por fim, em nossos pratos. O mesmo acontece em criações de peixes ao redor de todo o mundo. Taryn Bishop, uma ativista ambiental, se encontrará com Green Warriors, uma organização de conservação sediada em Bergen, no litoral oeste da Noruega. A Green Warriors investiga as práticas devastadoras da criação de peixes no ecossistema local há anos e vai levar a Taryn para ver o lado sombrio das criações escondidas abaixo da superfície. Um submarino especial permitiu que eles vissem o fundo do mar abaixo das gaiolas. Ao longo de todo o fundo do mar, há uma camada espessa de lodo composto de resíduos de peixe, bactérias e alimentos não ingeridos. O lodo está cheio de pesticidas adicionados à comida. Novos estudos demonstram que as doses enormes de pesticidas sendo adicionadas ao ecossistema marinho em todo o mundo em criações de peixes têm um efeito devastador na biodiversidade natural do oceano. O lodo também libera grandes quantidades de metano, o gás do efeito estufa. Pesquisadores da Universidade de Oxford dizem que certos tipos de piscicultura estão liberando mais metano do que a produção da carne bovina. Liv Holmfjord é a chefe da Secretaria da Pesca norueguesa. Na Noruega, recebemos informações que ela não só é responsável pela regulamentação da indústria de criação de peixes do país, mas também tem ações em uma das maiores fazendas de peixe da Noruega. Grupos ambientais consideram isso como um grande conflito de interesse. Holmfjord concordou em se encontrar com Taryn para discutir sobre o estado das fazendas de peixes no país.
Well, fish farming is quite a new industry in Norway. It started back in the 1960s with some local entrepreneurs starting with hobby, and it's grown until it's a billion euro industry today. And seafood is the second largest export industry in Norway, and fish farming accounts for 2/3 of the export value of seafood.
So recently, we found out that you also have shares in one of the largest fish farm companies in Norway. Do you not feel that that's a conflict of interest?
Of course, there could be a conflict of interest, but this is a fact that's been known since before I got this position, and I've been open about it. I'm not involved in the business from day to day or at any, so it's, and if there's, we have, and I have, so I have to, do you have to start over again? So all the decisions that I made will either be for the whole industry, not specially for this fish farm, or it's only an advice to the politicians, and the politicians are setting the limits and the actual regulations. So if there's an actual case handling regarding this company, then I will step aside.
A few jobs and I was working here over the years as a diver. We used to be around the fish farms cleaning the dead, deceased fish from the nets and fixing the nets, etc. after storms. And on occasion, we'd seen some of the boats coming in to clean the lice off them. it's quite a lot of dead fish, you know, diseased or they've died. But it's a lot of pink mush, you know, not healthy look. Having seen what I've seen and worked on the various sites round about where I've been in Scotland, I wouldn't eat farmed salmon. No, I would have pretty rank.
Salmon is marketed as healthy. It's also marketed in a very devious way, deceptive way, that they think it's a wild product. So it's a fake product, it's a fatty product, it's contaminated, it's marketed as healthy, but it's not. So salmon, if you see salmon, alarm bells should start ringing.
It's pretty grim when you dive down to the bottom of the cages because, you know, we always see the bottom full of dead fish. And it's basically because many of these fish are so diseased, so parasite-ridden and laden with chemicals that they become sick and they live out their sad, short lives basically looking like zombies. You know, you don't see this when you go to the restaurant or the supermarket, but this is basically what a lot of the fish actually look like before it ends up on our plates. So tonight, Don wanted to show us how much of the farmed fish actually dies. Because of the very unnatural and unsanitary ways that they are kept, and they have rows of very large metal containers that they are constantly filling up with the dead fish. And I have to say that the smell as we get closer is actually pretty disgusting.
So this is the sordid side of salmon farming in Scotland. This is the dirty secrets the industry don't want you to see. This is disease-ridden farmed salmon. It's 15 to 20% fat. That's where the contaminants, the cancer-causing contaminants, PCBs, dioxins, and the artificial colorings are. So this is something to be avoided at all costs.
This is the salmon farm just here. We got freedom of information data from the Scottish Environment Protection Agency showing the use of over 50 tons of formaldehyde, not just at this site but other sites across Scotland. Is formaldehyde may cause cancer, suspected of causing genetic defects, toxic if swallowed, may cause respiratory irritation, causes damage to organs, do not breathe.
One of the fish farm workers told us that the workers come down to the farm early in the morning spraying the chemicals into the fish cages. So they're obviously spraying something down there in the water. The guy who gave us the tip-off said that toxic chemicals are widely used across Scotland, including formaldehyde and also hydrogen peroxide. And these are supposed to treat the diseases and lice problems which are both rampant across the fish farms. You know, these are not chemicals that you want in your body. Whatever he's spraying must be pretty powerful if he needs to wear full protective chemical suit and a face mask.
Conforme o mar se torna um lixão para 7 bilhões de pessoas e as fazendas saturam seus peixes com comida química, comer peixe nunca foi tão tóxico.
You know, our oceans have become humanity's sewers. Everything eventually flows into the sea. So if you had a, you know, time machine that go back before the Industrial Revolution, it's a different story. But now, the highest levels of many of these persistent organic pollutants, we're talking about, you know, DDT and PCBs and dioxins, the highest levels in our food supply are found in the aquatic food chain. Fish are not the safest choice anymore.
So, Tony, it's great to see you.
Great to see you as well. Thanks for coming.
Not at all. Thank you. A pleasure being here. So I wanted to ask you if you could share with us what exactly it was you began to feel when you realized something was going wrong.
I was exhausted more than usual, and then I was losing short-term memory, and that scared the hell out of me. And then I tore my rotator cuffs in a really intense snowboarding accident. And the doctor said, do you want to do your metals test? And I said, I got my amalgams out 25 years ago. He goes, there's so many metals in the environment, you should do it. So I did. I get a phone call a week later, and I said to my assistant, just have him send the report. And he said, no, it's an emergency. He has to speak to you. And it's like, no one wants to hear that. And so I called him up, and he said, Tony, I showed your blood tests. You have extreme mercury poisoning. On a 0 to 5 scale, which is what we measure, 5 being toxic, you're 123. The doctor said, how long has this man been in the hospital? And I just got off stage. So I said, I can't understand this. So I went out, and they thought, you know, maybe someone's trying to poison me because the number was so high. And I was very disciplined. I was a vegan for 12 years, and then I just went salad fish. And they brought the medical group out here, and they looked at it, and I found this man named Dr. Shade, who's the only guy who has an ideation process where he can see where the mercury came from, and it was fish. Mm-hmm. It's been 3 years, and I had some severe moments. It burned a hole in my esophagus, and I literally collapsed. I lost a third of my blood supply. I could have died. I lost half my hemoglobin.
People begin to lose their hair,
Yes. Their
memory. They lose their memories, as you noticed. But they can also have headaches. They can complain of fatigue. They can also have depression. What we're seeing now is with the toxic environmental exposure, and especially with the mercury, methyl mercury in fish, is that everyone has got to be careful because the levels are going up.
Udo, tell me, because your specialty is in this, how do you get the fish oils that we all need for the brain and for the body if we can't have fish? What do you suggest?
Well, we used to get them from fish oils.
Yes.
We can actually get them from vegetables. Flax is the richest source of omega-3 that everybody thinks should come from fish oil. If you get enough of that as starting material, your body will make what the fish oils make and it'll be clean.
Many people take fish oils or have fish for the long chain omega-3 fatty acids. And you have to ask yourself the question, well, where do the fish get them from? And it turns out they get them from the algae in the ocean. They get them from plant food. So if you want the purest form of the long chain ready-made omega-3 fatty acids, the best way of doing that is simply to take an algae supplement, because then you've got the purest form of it and you don't have the extra risks of having the toxins and the heavy metals and the saturated fat and the cholesterol that you would get from eating a fish.
Estudo revisado por pares de cientistas da instituição Scripps de Oceanografia da UC San Diego foi dos maiores estudos sobre poluentes de peixes no mundo. Cientistas acharam poluentes tóxicos em peixes em todos os oceanos do mundo.
Nobody would go to the nearest body of water and put in like a cup and drink the water. You're basically getting the concentrated toxins if we're eating fish.
Nossos oceanos também estão cheios de plástico. Como os oceanos são enormes, é desafio para qualquer cientista compreender claramente de onde vem a maior parte desse plástico. O grande lixão do Pacífico, cobrindo uma área de cerca de 1,6 milhões de quilômetros quadrados, pode oferecer uma chance única de entender melhor o problema crescente do microplástico no mar. Uma equipe de cientistas da organização Ocean Cleanup tem estudado o lixão há um tempo e ficou surpresa ao descobrir que a maior parte do plástico no lixão não vem de canudos velhos ou garrafas de águas usadas, mas de milhares de toneladas de equipamentos de pesca descartados, quebrados pelo mar em trilhões de pedacinhos de microplástico. Um estudo publicado recentemente no periódico Nature mostrou que quase 80% do plástico no Pacífico é composto de equipamentos de pesca descartados. Muitos cientistas concordam que uma das melhores coisas que nós, como indivíduos, podemos fazer para resolver a questão do plástico no mar é deixar de comer peixes e seguir uma dieta baseada em plantas.
At least half of the plastic in the sea today comes from discarded or lost fishing gear. Because all those nets, all those lines, all that stuff, it's just become a plasticized ocean. But we have a chance. We have a chance right now to change our eating habits.
There's an estimate that there's over 5 trillion tons of plastic currently floating in the ocean. It's absolutely everywhere. Everywhere we look, we found microplastics, whether it's at the polar regions, in remote islands. Also, if we're looking on the surface or the seabed, and everywhere in between, we find microplastics. We've also found microplastics in just about every animal group that we've looked in. We've been sampling for microplastics for quite a while now, and we found that there's 27 times more bits of plastic than there are fish larvae.
Microplânctons são encontrados por todo o oceano. Eles são como filtros. Quando pesquisadores adicionam microplásticos no ambiente dos plânctons, eles os observam consistentemente ingerindo as partículas de plásticos, sem saber que essas partículas são compostas por produtos tóxicos. Os plânctons as consomem indiscriminadamente. Os cientistas observam como as substâncias químicas se acumulam dentro dos órgãos dessas pequenas criaturas marinhas. Os plânctons tóxicos são então ingeridos pelos peixes maiores, e cientistas descobriram que a maioria dos peixes que consumimos hoje bioacumularam essas substâncias em sua carne. Da Universidade de Plymouth constatou que mais de um terço de todos os peixes testados continham microplásticos. Conforme comemos esses peixes contaminados, ingerimos as mesmas substâncias químicas tóxicas em nosso corpo, e pesquisas recentes sugerem um acúmulo tóxico semelhante em humanos.
Our scientists tell us we're now in the 6th extinction event of life on this Earth. It doesn't even make the headlines. No one even knows about it. We've had 5 mass extinction events on this planet in 450 million years. Let me be clear on this. The last time we had an extinction event of this magnitude was 65 million years ago.
It's incredibly sad to realize just how many species, both in the oceans and on land, that we're losing at the moment. And it's up to all of us to make sure that this doesn't happen in the future.
Today, over 26,000 species are currently threatened with extinction, and the most important driver of that
is our use of land for agriculture.
Over time, livestock have been a major, major driver of biodiversity loss.
Some have predicted that by 2045, the species loss will be so great that we won't recover. The Earth will suffer ecological collapse. And the biggest thing you and I can do is change our diet.
Alguns cientistas começaram a chamar essa crise atual de aniquilação biológica. Segundo o periódico Science of the Total Environment da Universidade Internacional da Flórida, a pecuária é a principal causa da perda da biodiversidade. Segundo um estudo lançado no periódico Science, se o mundo todo passasse a se alimentar apenas de plantas, nós liberaríamos mais de 75% da terra arável do mundo. E muitas das florestas já devastadas para a pecuária poderiam ser restauradas. Existem hoje iniciativas maravilhosas no mundo fazendo exatamente isso. Ecosia, um mecanismo de busca online semelhante ao Google, é uma dessas iniciativas que usa o lucro gerado por anúncios para pagar comunidades locais para replantar árvores. Um dos principais silvicultores da Ecosia é Maurício, que tem trabalhado para replantar a floresta tropical no Brasil.
Plantei minha primeira árvore, tinha 5 anos de idade. Eu nem imaginava que 20 anos depois, esse esforço tão pequeno teria virado uma das iniciativas que mais plantou árvores na história do Brasil. Foram mais de 2,5 milhões de árvores, 2,000 hectares plantados, muitas áreas preservadas pela ação de combate a incêndios florestais.
As árvores sopram vida ao nosso mundo. Quando plantamos uma árvore, colocamos as sementes do nosso futuro nesse planeta. O estudo detalhado mais recente sobre o impacto ambiental do que comemos foi um periódico revisado por pares de um grupo de pesquisadores internacionais. Este estudo pioneiro, regido pelo Dr. Marco Springman, da Universidade de Oxford, na Inglaterra, mostrou que para mantermos as temperaturas abaixo do limite perigoso de 2 graus Celsius, definido no Acordo Climático de Paris em países de alta renda, precisamos reduzir nosso consumo de carne por cerca de 80%.
Policymakers have been very, very reluctant to address the livestock issue. It's entirely out of keeping with the urgency of the crisis that we're facing.
Hi, Otto Brockway for Brockstar Films. This is a question for Commissioner Hogan. The scientists at Oxford University have been very clear that livestock farming has a far greater impact than plant-based farming. With this in mind, would it not be common sense to reduce the billions in subsidy payments to livestock farming in Europe and offer them to plant-based farming instead as an incentive to a much more sustainable food system?
We have made our proposals based on protecting the farmers because they are, unlike you and I, they're out in all sorts of weathers and in all sorts of market risks. And you and I may not know anything about that because this is their lives. This is their producing high quality food for us all so that we can have this particular good quality products available to us at all times. Sometimes under local conditions like organic, more times as conventional farming. So we provide financial support at the moment for that. And it's a public good that's not always recognized. But the movement of our policy is in the direction of our farmers being centrally involved in providing more public goods. And if you want to do anything in life, you have to pay people. Sometimes I understand that there's a moral obligation and there's people of principle, but most of the time, 99% of the time, they have to get paid. So as professionals that we're expecting to provide good quality food and do more on public goods, we pay our farmers. This is a decision that we make at political level.
Livestock emit methane and nitrous oxide. Now, most people, when they think of climate change, they think of CO2, carbon dioxide, which is a very potent global warming gas. But methane is 25 times more potent per molecule when it's released than CO2. And nitrous oxide is 298 times more potent per molecule than CO2. These are very powerful global warming gases.
So today we have a very special camera called a hyperspectral imaging camera, and it basically enables us to be able to see gases that would be otherwise invisible to the naked eye. And today we're looking at methane gas. Methane is a gas that is being produced by cows when they belch.
O metano, junto com outros gases produzidos na atmosfera, já causou um terço do aquecimento global desde 1750. O gado é a maior fonte de metano que podemos controlar. Reduções drásticas nas emissões de metano podem retardar o aquecimento global em 15 a 25 anos, sendo esse o meio mais eficaz que temos para reduzir o aquecimento dos anos críticos adiante.
Whoa, look at that.
Para demonstrar os diferentes potenciais de aquecimento dos gases climáticos, podemos ver um experimento chamado Experimento de Absorção Infravermelha. Aqui temos quatro estátuas de gelo no formato da Terra, cada uma em uma câmara hermética. As câmaras representam a atmosfera que envolve o planeta. Cada uma tem um aquecedor infravermelho, configurados na mesma temperatura, e cada uma é então preenchida com um gás diferente. A primeira câmara recebe o ar normal que respiramos todos os dias. A segunda câmara é preenchida com dióxido de carbono, um conhecido gás do efeito estufa. A terceira câmara é preenchida com metano, um gás associado à pecuária. E a quarta câmara é preenchida com óxido nitroso, outro gás associado à pecuária. Com o tempo, começamos a ver o gelo da câmara de dióxido de carbono derreter levemente em comparação ao normal. Mas no mesmo curto tempo, as estátuas nas câmaras de metano e óxido nitroso começam a derreter rápido, conforme a temperatura interna fica bem mais alta do que no ar normal e também no dióxido de carbono. 16 horas depois, o resultado é claro. Podemos ver claramente que o metano e o óxido nitroso, os principais subprodutos gasosos da pecuária, são gases potentes do aquecimento global. Dos 70 bilhões de animais terrestres que estimamos ser criados para o consumo humano a cada ano no mundo todo, quase 90% são frangos. Um problema emergente é que o consumo de frango está aumentando. Apesar de o impacto ambiental do frango ser menor do que da carne vermelha, mais de 90% dos frangos no mundo hoje são criados intensamente, e isso tem efeitos devastadores no nosso planeta. Ao comparar as calorias de proteínas similares com carne e vegetais, como grão de bico, o frango prejudica menos o meio ambiente do que as carnes vermelhas mais consumidas. Mesmo assim, ainda causa 40 vezes mais aquecimento global por caloria de proteína que o grão de bico e usa 50 vezes mais água.
We know that if we would shift from ruminant meats to other meats, then we probably would reduce our footprint just from that particular product by about a factor of 10, which is quite a bit. But if you compare that with how much you would reduce your footprint if you went to plant-based products, that is about a factor of 100. And that's the reason why shifting towards more plant-based diets has such a big impact, because we're really talking about different scales here.
Dizem que a carne orgânica tem menor impacto ambiental. Porém, um estudo realizado por pesquisadores em Oxford descobriu que, na verdade, a carne orgânica, ou produzida tradicionalmente, faz pouca diferença nas emissões de gases do efeito estufa.
So in our data, we didn't find big differences between organic and conventional across multiple indicators. What we did find is that no matter how you produce animal products, even the lowest impact forms of production still create higher emissions and use more land than typical vegetable proteins. So that's saying something really important. That's saying that even if you go into the shops and try and purchase sustainable meat or dairy, it's always going to be better to purchase vegetable proteins instead.
Todo ano, o governo dos Estados Unidos dá cerca de 20 milhões de dólares para o cultivo de frutas e verduras. Mas a produção de carne e laticínios recebe incríveis 38 bilhões do governo. Estima-se que o custo anual dos cofres públicos com doenças causadas pelo consumo de carne e laticínios seja de cerca de 314 bilhões de dólares.
When you cram, tens of thousands of animals in these cramped, filthy, unhygienic conditions, basically live atop their feces, it's just like a breeding ground. Animal to human diseases that arise because of the way we're now treating animals, whether it's these live animal markets in East Asia, whether it's the bushmeat trade. And the concern is that with enough spins at genetic roulette on these swine factory farms, these chicken factory farms, we're gonna, end up with one of these viruses that's not only deadly to chickens, but can jump and transmit human to human and cause the next human pandemic.
The risk of large-scale factory farmings increases the risk that we, or the likelihood that we might have a pandemic, particularly of influenza in the future.
This pandemic has been very severe, but this is not necessarily the big one.
Acredita-se que a gripe suína, que matou quase 500 mil de pessoas, tenha se originado em uma suinocultura. Acredita-se que o vírus da AIDS e do ebola tenham vindo do consumo de animais silvestres, enquanto a MERS veio dos camelos e também da carne e leite de camelos. Presume-se que a SARS se alastrou de mercados de animais vivos, assim como a recente pandemia da Covid-19. Acredita-se que a gripe aviária tenha se iniciado em fazendas de aves e também em mercados de animais vivos. E acredita-se que o vírus do sarampo se originou em fazendas de gado.
People know now what a global pandemic feels like. They've seen the effects, they will be feeling the effects for many years to come. And this is a chance, I think, an opportunity to point out that this particular route of infection is a very concerning one.
A Organização Mundial da Saúde anunciou que a era pós-antibiótico está próxima. Uma época em que um simples arranhão no braço poderá se tornar fatal. Nossos antibióticos milagrosos estão se tornando inúteis devido ao uso em excesso. Não pelos humanos, mas porque os damos diariamente a bilhões de animais de granja.
Being a butcher for 6 years, one thing I know is that if people knew what happened in the production of their food, they wouldn't eat meat. So one of the things that we would hit every day was pus nodules, tumors, cysts. It was something that we would hit on a daily basis. Having worked in a supermarket chain, I saw this firsthand every single day. So here's one that's running along the shoulder blade.
Oh. Yeah.
That is what I remember in the butchery. It comes out like a thick toothpaste. I remember that every single day.
That's interesting to hear you had that experience all the way over there, because in the UK, exactly the same.
Yeah.
We would see that on a daily basis. But those people who say it's not my butcher does this, they need to open their eyes, because if their butcher's being honest with them, we know.
Yeah.
We both know. Honest butcher's going to admit it. They're not going to want to tell the public because it's going to affect their business. Yeah. But it is a fact.
And me working in multiple butcheries, I saw these common trends across the board. So I know that it wasn't just isolated to the one that I was working in. It was across the board for me.
People need to reconnect with what they're eating, and the whole process that we're talking about here of how that food gets to them. It's hidden from them, and it's hidden for a reason, because if they saw it, it would most definitely make them want to think harder about what they're eating.
Conforme nossos oceanos e atmosfera aquecem, os ciclos de água do planeta começam a mudar.
Climate change changes the water cycles of the planet. The heat that's being generated is forcing the precipitation into the clouds, so we're getting more concentrated precipitation in our clouds and more dramatic, extreme, and unpredictable water events all over the world.
Na região norte da ilha remota de Taiwan, no Pacífico, o povo Atayal vive no topo das montanhas. Taiwan está acostumado com climas extremos, mas recentemente a força e a frequência dos tufões aumentaram. Isso teve um efeito devastador no povo Atayal e em sua forma de vida. Enquanto grande parte do mundo tem vivenciado cada vez mais enchentes extremas, em muitos lugares o oposto está acontecendo. Grande parte do mundo está vivendo cada vez mais uma seca extrema, destruindo milhares de toneladas de plantações, enquanto milhões de fazendeiros lutam para achar água suficiente para os seus campos.
I'm definitely worried about the future of our farm. I think we're seeing, you know, much more many more swings in climate than we've seen in the past, but we want to use all the land that we have to grow food. But we haven't been able to just because of the shortages of water. It'll have an impact on food supply and prices and availability. And so estimates now are between 500,000 to over a million acres of farmland that'll come out of production in California.
Almeria, no sul da Espanha, abriga 31 mil hectares de fazendas internas de vegetais. Almeria produz metade das frutas e vegetais da Europa, um elemento essencial no fornecimento do sistema alimentar do continente. De forma preocupante, a Espanha tem sofrido com a seca há 20 anos, uma seca que especialistas dizem ter relação com as mudanças climáticas.
In terms of water, the truth is that the drought in Spain has become a complete catastrophe. Our harvests are decreasing in massive quantities. Last year, in the area we are now, there was almost no harvest. People don't realize the food system is collapsing.
Como resultado da mudança no sistema climático global, a seca na África piorou. Rios e lagos que abastecem a água potável a centenas de milhões de pessoas estão começando a secar. Com novos conflitos surgindo por esses recursos escassos, estamos presenciando o início de um êxodo em massa de pessoas indo para o norte, desesperadas para sobreviver. Esses refugiados do clima estão dispostos a arriscar tudo para levar suas famílias ao que eles consideram o litoral seguro da Europa. Em resposta a essa migração em massa dos dias atuais, a Espanha construiu um muro enorme em toda a sua fronteira sul, em Melilla. Milhares de refugiados estão começando a atravessar as cercas da fronteira, sobrecarregando a polícia espanhola. Com previsões que esse padrão migratório deve aumentar, fica cada vez mais claro que nosso mundo está mal preparado para enfrentar isso.
Osval, Andrel. Osquiherbet, Mohulpur.
deserto de Gobi, na Mongólia, começa a se espalhar cada vez mais pelo país, como uma fera consumindo toda a vida em seu caminho. Muitos dos lagos que sustentam as pessoas e a vida selvagem secaram. Se os lagos continuarem a desaparecer, as pessoas serão obrigadas a abandonar suas casas e ir para terras distantes e desconhecidas.
Сайхан байсан цаг, сайхан сар. Өгсчүүл хангад ирэх нэг л өөр болоод байна гэж. Монголчууд байгаль дэлхийдээ дасан зогцож амьдэрсаар ирсэн. Гэхдээ байгаль орчин арай л дэндүү огцом хөвсөж байна удаа гэж. Энэ дэлхий дээр амь өрсөж үлдэхийн тулд ихэл тэвчээртэй хатуужилтай байх хэрэгтэй болох нь дээ.
A lot of people talk about how much fresh water we use for hydrofracking. 700 billion gallons globally is wasted on fracking. So 700 billion gallons. Sounds like a lot. But animal agriculture, the production of animals that we use for meat around the globe, uses 70 trillion gallons of fresh water a year. Hundreds of thousands of times as much as fracking. And we give the cows and the chickens the good stuff, right? They don't get the Flint, Michigan, lead-tainted condoms floating in it water. They get the top-shelf stuff because we don't want to screw up our sausage links. And I know what some of you are thinking right now. You're thinking, oh, here's the part. I'm a vegetarian and pigs are people too, meh. But no, let's ignore how the animals are treated in our factory torture farming. Let's pretend they're treated amazing. For just a minute, it's like a celebrity backstage at the Oscars. They're just being fawned over and they get swag bags with free Apple Watches. Point is, you should still be upset about this because animal agriculture is killing us. And corporate media is fantastically pathetic on this topic. They never mention meat production. They never mention that a quarter pounder takes 660 gallons of fresh water to create. That's the equivalent of showering for 2 months.
So one usually underestimated impact of livestock production is the huge amounts of fresh water required for that production to be maintained and to be increased.
The problem is that in many places water is being used much faster than the natural renewal rates. Overall, in the world, 1.8 billion people are living in areas with severe water scarcity. The livestock sector is the single biggest water user in the world. One-third of the water use in the world is being used for producing animal products, meat and dairy. And it's not because those animals drink so much, it's really because there's a lot of water required to make the feed for the animals.
If we want enough fresh water for future generations, water alone dictates that we must change our diet away from meat and dairy.
No mundo todo, podemos ver evidência de uma transição global em direção a uma dieta sem produtos animais, o suficiente para nos dar esperança. Em 2021, um número recorde de 580 mil pessoas se inscreveu na campanha Veganuary no Reino Unido. Estima-se que hoje mais de 4 milhões de pessoas se identifiquem como veganas em todo o Reino Unido. No Canadá, estima-se que 10% da população seja vegana ou vegetariana. Nos Estados Unidos, mais de 50% dos chefes incluíram itens veganos ao cardápio, com um aumento de 600% no estilo de vida vegano nos últimos 3 anos.
A few years ago, it was quite a challenge to get hold of good vegan food, but today we're pretty much spoiled for choice and there are vegan options everywhere.
Wow, thanks. It tastes like a normal hot dog. Is it a normal hot dog? Like, as in, like, or is this, like, plant-based or something?
It is actually plant-based, yeah.
It's really nice. I prefer it, because I don't really eat meat that much, so this is good.
Okay. I like meat and it tastes good.
Yeah?
For not being meat.
Would you be happy with that?
Yeah, I've been stoked. I love meat too much. So I feel like if I went plant-based, I'd miss it. But if this like stuff tastes the same,
yeah,
I'd be very happy with this.
Nice and messy fingers.
It is, yeah. Good burger. Thank you.
It would interest you to know that that's completely plant-based.
And I wouldn't know. So that, I would definitely,
wow,
that's a winner.
Yeah, I'm amazed.
If burgers always tasted like that, would you be happy to just not eat a beef burger
again? Yeah, no, I got food radio, yeah.
Yeah? I'd like you to tell me which one of these nuggets is plant-based and which one is real meat.
Okay. It's very hard to say which one is...
They taste exactly the same, honestly.
These are not the chicken.
No.
That's interesting.
Which one of this is animal meat, and which one of this is plant-based? Meat or not meat? You're not sure.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
Meat.
You?
Yes.
Are wrong. Okay. But you think the second one was chicken?
Yeah.
The second one was actually plant-based.
No way.
Yeah, and the first one was chicken.
No way.
Yeah.
Okay, I couldn't have guessed that. I definitely thought the first one, yeah, definitely.
It seems that changing what we eat to a more sustainable diet can also coincidentally be very beneficial to our health. There is a growing understanding that we can actually prevent, and in many cases even reverse, some of our most common diseases all through a shift towards a whole food vegan diet.
Humans can survive on many different kinds of diet, but many decades of research has now shown us that the best way of not just surviving but truly thriving is on a whole food plant-based diet.
A human can be healthy on a plant-based diet without any animal products. The major dietetic associations around the world, including the British Dietetic Association, have produced statements to say exactly that, that a diet made up of whole plant foods is healthy for humans all stages of their life.
And not only can they be healthy, but they can restore or reclaim their health adopting a plant-based diet.
There are certain areas, certain populations around the world that have extraordinary health and longevity. For example, the largest number of centenarians, people that live over 100, these so-called blue zones.
What's really interesting about the blue zones, they actually have more centenarians than anywhere else in the world. And a centenarian is someone that lives at least 100 years. But what's really interesting about the blue zones is when people reach these advanced ages, they are still productive. So the blue zones have taught us a lot. And the bottom line is we really want to try to emulate what the people of the blue zones are doing.
As cinco regiões conhecidas como zonas azuis são Okinawa, no Japão, Sardenha, na Itália, Icária, na Grécia, Nicoya, na Costa Rica, e Loma Linda, na Califórnia.
So the question is, well, what do they all have in common?
They have a predominantly plant-based diet. They have a diet rich in fruits and vegetables, whole grains, beans, soy, lentils, chickpeas. They have a diet rich in all these nutrients, and that's one thing that they have in common.
So the EPIC study is the European Prospective Investigation into Cancer and Nutrition. It followed over 500,000 individuals from 10 European countries for more than 15 years. Those in the EPIC study that were eating predominantly plant-based or eating high levels of fruits and vegetables lived longer, had lower incidence of cancer and heart disease. About 2,500 of the individuals in the EPIC Oxford only ate plant food, so they were vegan. And even though they weren't the most healthy vegans or healthy plant eaters, you could show that these plant eaters were healthier. They had a lower incidence of heart disease, diabetes, and cancer.
From everything we have discovered on this journey, it seems that moving away from animal foods to plant-based foods instead can not only give us a whole host of amazing health benefits, but also gives us a chance to be able to leave a sustainable planet for future generations to come. Perhaps the single most meaningful change that we can make as individuals is ultimately deciding what ends up each day on our plates.
We are running out of time. The world community
must acknowledge that animal agriculture is the most destructive industry on our planet. We can't wait for government policies and other organizations to create a better life for ourselves. We need to stand up now and make our voices heard.
Globally, for the typical consumer, avoiding meat and dairy is probably the single biggest way to reduce your impact on Earth.
Without addressing what we eat, we simply won't make it.
This is a number one priority. This is a next step in taking responsibility for our communities, our planet, our biosphere, our fellow species.
People say, what can I do as an individual? It feels overwhelming. Well, you can make individual choices. We all can. Our individual choices affect the collective choices. When you hear about airplanes and cars, and we're still going to use those things. But the choices we make in our diet, this agricultural business where we use animals as the primary source of protein, the one thing I think we can all do as individuals is make our own individual choices, how we're going to live, how we're going to eat. Plant-based diet makes all the difference in the world. Just make some choices that are good for you, and being good for you will be good for the planet.
Esse planeta é a nossa casa. O que acontece agora só depende de nós. A história nos mostrou que quando estamos juntos, unidos por uma causa comum, podemos conquistar coisas incríveis. À nossa frente, temos a oportunidade de construir um mundo em que podemos florescer. Mas o relógio não para. E o tempo está chegando ao fim.